Ladies and gentlemen, now I'd like to introduce the five Army component speakers of our lightning talks. To kick it off, we have Lindsay Holden. Her topic will be efforts towards environmental exposure monitoring.
Hi there. I am Lindsay Holden. I am a phase two SMART scholar, and in August, I will be transitioning to phase three of this program. SMART supported me for 3 years of my PhD program at Portland State University in Portland, Oregon, and I now work at the U.S. Army Public Health Center in Aberdeen, Proving Ground, Maryland. At the Public Health Center, I work within the Toxicology Directorate to help understand some of the potential toxicity of compounds and chemicals that are in the research, development, test, and evaluation process, moving into new materials, new systems, or updates to things that we currently have in place, with the goal of collecting data that's relevant to potential environmental or occupational health hazards. So we use in silico, which is computer or in vitro methods in the lab, cell culture based largely, as well as animal testing methods to understand some of the toxicology risks of these types of compounds. Some of the applications of what we do are surface finishing materials, illumination materials, fire suppressants, colored smokes, refrigerants, propellants, and explosives. So, for example, I'll walk you through an example of what we might do. Let's say we're developing, the Army is developing a new spray coating for tanks. So, in the early part of developing this new spray coating, when the chemists are working on all of the small molecules that are going into that spray, we would be involved doing computational predictions, looking at the chemical and physical properties of the ingredients in that spray and modeling to predict any potential toxicity. If everything looks good and safe, then their performance is good for that product, then they'll continue to develop the product, and we'll continue to look a little deeper for potential toxicity. So we'll, you know, move along the continuum, looking at doing some experiments in the physical and chemical properties and beginning to do some in vitro cell culture based toxicity screening tests using human cell lines or aquatic organisms. And then as that product gets nearer and nearer to being prototyped and fielded, we'll get into animal studies where we'll look at toxicity, acute toxicity, and long-term toxicity, including potential developmental risk or cancer risk. And so we collect this data as items are in development so that if there is a toxicity risk, we can provide that information to decision makers and they can use that as they decide whether or not to move that product along in the development process. I specifically have three major projects right now. The first is working on fluorine-free replacements for aqueous film-forming foams, AFFFs, trying to replace old technology, old chemicals that we know have human and environmental toxicity hazards, with something that is less toxic. But since once you develop a replacement, you need to do the toxicity testing to confirm that it's less toxic to avoid regrettable substitutions. I also am working on a neurotoxicity assay battery. This is a in vitro cell culture-based assay system where we have multiple tests that we're developing, including some computational modeling, to understand whether chemicals or compounds have any risk of being neurotoxic or impacting the nervous system, either the central nervous system like your brain or your peripheral nervous system like all the nerves in your fingers and toes. I also am working on a very large effort to stand up a dried blood spot repository and use that repository for some biosurveillance efforts for the Department of Defense. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that. So dried blood spots are where you take a small lancet, you prick your finger, and you drip a small drop of blood onto a filter paper card. That card is dried and then stored away until you want to test it. We use this commonly now in the US for infant screening. It's the heel stick test, where we can assess metabolic and genomic diseases in newborns. And over a million newborns are tested this way every year. Our goal is to use this technology to help link environmental exposures to health outcomes, because right now we are not collecting samples from soldiers if they have known or expected environmental exposures at or near the time of exposure. Those samples may be collected, but it could be months away from when they had the potential exposure. And so our solution is to use these dried blood spots. There's an image here I'm showing of an actual card with five dried blood spots. And then for analysis, we take a little punch out a hole, and you can see there's a hole punched in one of those drops and it's in a small tube. And then we would take that, extract it, and run it through various types of analytical machines to look for our target of interest. Maybe we're trying to look at the level of lead in the blood. And the benefits of this technology are that it's very cheap to collect these samples. You don't need a trained clinical professional. Once those samples are dried on the card, they're very stable. You can do this in the field. So if you're deployed somewhere, you could yourself collect this sample. And then they can just be shipped in the regular mail back to home base to be stored or assessed for potential exposures. And another benefit is that this is a whole blood. Current practices use serum, which is just a portion of a blood product. So we're very excited about this technology. And thus far in the effort towards a dried blood spot repository, I have been chairing a multi-organization working group. Army Public Health Center is the lead agency to develop and publish a concept plan for what the dried blood spot repository might look like. We have began a couple proof of concepts of using dried blood spots. One is using military working dogs, which is a collaboration between APHC, the DOD, Military Working Dog Veterinary Service, Public Health Activity Fort Belvoir, and all of the National Capital Region of Veterinary Treatment Facilities. We're also looking into expanded applications for dried blood spots. In this case, I'm looking at application to subconcussive traumatic brain injury and using dried blood spots as a biomarker screening tool. And this is a collaboration between myself at APHC and Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. And the Department of Defense Warfighter Brain Health Initiative is tracking this effort, which is pretty exciting because it could have some really important implications for how we screen our soldiers. And this project actually is funded by the Smart Seed Program, which I'll talk about a little bit in a second. To wrap up, I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about how SMART has impacted my career. It supported the majority of my PhD program. My summer internships, while a SMART scholar, allowed me to understand what my future job would look like and tailor my training in graduate school to support that future career. And then, of course, allowed me to move directly into a DoD position at APHC. And since I've been a phase two scholar at APHC, I've been able to be involved in multiple multi-agency collaborations. I was awarded the Smart Seed funding for this fiscal year, which is a great startup program for PhD Smart Scholars. Once you've transitioned out of your graduate program into your sponsor facility, that can provide you up to 3 years of funding to get a program up and running. And also, I really enjoy working on projects that have potential DoD-wide impacts, like the dried blood spot repository. We have impacts in as short a timeline as 1 year, and we're looking forward to 5, 10, 15, 20 years in the future, looking to address and prevent future issues associated with long-term health effects due to environmental exposures. So thank you for your time. I appreciate you listening to this talk, and I look forward to any questions.
Thank you, Lindsay. Next up, we have Elise Baroncini. Her topic will be lithium ion battery research in defense applications.
Hello, my name is Elise Baroncini, and I'm going to speak to you today about the work I do on lithium-ion batteries for defense applications. I'm a 2017 Smart Scholar recipient, and I received my PhD in chemical engineering from Rowan University in New Jersey in 2019. I'm currently working with my sponsoring facility, which is the U.S. Army DEVCOM C5ISR Center Power Division in Aberdeen Proving Ground, Maryland. The aim of my research is to improve the material components in lithium-ion batteries for better battery performance and safety. But I also perform work outside of the lab where I coordinate and collaborate with other government organizations and companies in industry on efforts to advance new battery technologies. All of this battery research and engineering and development work aims to create better batteries for DoD applications. So that includes batteries with higher energy and power capabilities to power weaponry and mission critical survivability equipment. It also includes improving energy and power densities of batteries, thereby making lighter batteries to reduce soldier worn weight burden. And such work also encompasses improving the safety aspects of lithium ion batteries to enable further incorporation into soldier worn devices and especially onto aircraft. Today, I'm going to give you an overview of a specific research program that I've been working on. In my organization, we can apply for research grants called In-House Laboratory Independent Research, or ILR projects. I was awarded funding for an ILR project to perform investigation of safe polymer electrolytes with high voltage electrode materials in lithium ion batteries. To achieve both performance and safety improvements at the battery level, we must improve the individual components that comprise a battery. Batteries are complex and can vary in design depending on chemistry and application. But in general, lithium-ion batteries can consist of one or more subunits known as cells. Each cell can then consist of multiple layers of components, such as electrodes, separators, and electrolytes. The chemical reactions between the positive and negative electrodes, or cathode and anode as they are called, are the driving force of lithium battery technology. Electrolyte and separator materials that sit between the cathode and anode affect overall performance as well. So the challenge this research project aims to solve is that incumbent separator and electrolyte materials used in commercially available lithium-ion batteries are not necessarily compatible with the advanced electrode materials of the future. More specifically, commonly used liquid electrolytes and separators are not stable at the high voltages that will be required of future lithium-ion batteries, and are also not compatible with advanced anode materials that many are trying to employ. The instability and lack of robustness can lead to performance degradation and dangerous electrolyte breakdown or short circuiting, as depicted in the graphics on the right. Additionally, liquid electrolytes pose leakage and flammability risks, which present safety hazards in certain applications. The aim of my ILR research project is to develop a compatible electrolyte called a polymer electrolyte, which is a solid material that can withstand high voltage requirements, is stable with advanced anode materials, possesses no liquid solvent, thereby eliminating flammability and safety concerns, and has a lightweight and flexible form that is advantageous for future applications. This ILR project is an offshoot of my doctoral research at Rowan University. So the SMART scholarship and my resulting employment here at the US Army has allowed me to do sort of postdoctoral research. In the first year of my ILR project, I optimized a polymer electrolyte based on a type of chemistry known as thiolene chemistry. I evaluated the thermomechanical properties and electrochemical performance, and came to the conclusion that this polymer material could be a good candidate for lithium-ion battery applications. The polymer displayed average conductivities for polymer electrolytes, but had a high cationic transference value, which means it did a good job of transporting lithium ions. You can see a picture of a strip of the polymer material being folded in the top right of this slide. Next steps for this research that are taking place this year and next year in the second and third years of funding are to work on improving the interfacial contact between the thiolene polymer electrolyte and the electrodes. This is a difficult hurdle to overcome in most solid electrolyte research. Essentially, we must ensure that there is good contact at the interfaces of all of the multiple layers in the cell and battery that I spoke about before. Additionally, my work thus far has focused on making coin cells, as pictured in the bottom right. These are like the little batteries that go in your watches, and they are common laboratory scale test vehicles. But scaling up to larger size pouch cells that would actually be incorporated into commercial batteries presents problems of its own. So that is another iteration of research and engineering and optimization that will need to be done. And I've included down here in the last bullet that there are other ways to improve commonly used liquid electrolytes, such as making ceramic electrolytes, ionic liquid electrolytes, and incorporating other stabilizing additives to liquids. I have a couple of colleagues at my sponsoring facility who work on these methods as well, and we do collaborative work together in an effort to improve overall battery performance. And that leads me to my last slide. So a second research grant that I have received is the SMART Scholarship Seed Research Grant with my colleague, Dr. Robert Emmett, who is also a SMART Scholar, but on a different team at my sponsoring facility. That research grant is titled Advanced Halogenated Electrolytes for Improved Performance, Safety, and Cycle Life of High-Energy Lithium-Ion Batteries. In that work, Dr. Emmett and I are looking to develop tailored formulations of liquid and polymer electrolytes to enable a cathode material that was previously developed by engineers at our sponsoring facility. Outside of research, my position at my sponsoring facility that was a result of the SMART Scholarship has allowed me to be involved in the management and oversight of various contracted efforts and projects with industry working to advance battery technologies. This type of work has shown me how scientific advances actually get incorporated into battery products and has given me firsthand experience with how difficult it can be to get research from the lab bench into an actual product. And then that helps me when formulating and designing my own research projects here. Other awards and accomplishments are listed here, including the high school STEM outreach support I've been involved with. And with that, I'd like to thank the SMART Scholarship Program for their scholarship and support and the opportunity to present my work at this symposium. Thank you.
Thank you, Elise. Next up, we have Christopher Lasco. His topic will be automated land cover classification of remote sensing imagery with machine learning.
Hi, my name is Christopher Lasco, and I'll be sharing with you today about part of my research background, as well as a current project that I'm leading entitled Automated Land Cover Classification of Remote Sensing Imagery with Machine Learning. I first became a SMART Scholar in 2016 during my PhD program and began working full-time as a research geographer with the Geospatial Research Lab after my graduation in 2018. The Geospatial Research Lab, or GRL, is part of the Army Corps of Engineers, and it has an emphasis on conducting civil and environmental remote sensing research with satellite and unmanned aerial systems imagery. I work with different USAIS districts, including scientists, soldiers, and university professors. Prior to starting at GRL, my PhD research focused on using remote sensing, field research, and modeling to quantify air pollution from agricultural fires and the associated impacts on air quality. This work ultimately led to improved assessments of agricultural fires in the region, as well as applications abroad. My experience during this time with multimodal satellite remote sensing, such as synthetic aperture radar and multispectral imagery, helped prepare me to become a scientist with GRL. So now I'll introduce you generally to the research that I conduct at the Geospatial Research Laboratory. One of my main focuses is to conduct research with remotely sensed imagery, Python programming, and machine learning to create algorithms for land cover type mapping and feature extraction. These algorithms are integrated into decision support tools for targeted end users that we work with. The end users are typically scientists within USAIS Civil Works Division, or soldiers of the Army, as shown in that flowchart on the bottom left. Some applications that my research support include land cover, land use change mapping, environmental management, and habitat restoration, military operations, sensor integration, and geoint. So here's a flowchart of the methods that I use for one of the land cover mapping sub-projects that I'm working on at the moment. So in this project, we train machine learning classifiers to predict the land cover type from satellite imagery as shown on that right side set of images. So this is basically done by first training in an ensemble of support vector machine classifiers. These are specialized machine learning classifiers. And we use user-created feature labels of land cover type all across the United States. We then feed these into the support vector machine classifier and optimize the classifier until a desirable accuracy level is achieved. Ultimately, this land cover type prediction model is incorporated into a decision support tool using Python and integrated directly into ArcGIS Pro. This enables the end users to simply input a satellite image and get a land cover type product as an output, all within a GIS or geospatial information system. So as a part of this aforementioned sub-project on the last slide, we're working on making some improvements to it. So for example, the images shown here depict some misclassification errors between deciduous trees and evergreen trees, as well as cropland and bare areas. And I've pointed out a few example error locations with the arrows. So we're currently working on methods to resolve these errors, as well as other things such as incorporating improved mapping of snow covered areas, as our previous model did not account for this. So lastly, we're expanding our model outside of the United States to other regions and prototyping the development of automated training data. I'm also working on some basic research that integrates synthetic aperture radar and multispectral imagery for better all weather, all observing conditions, monitoring of the land surface. So as I mentioned, the algorithms that we developed are turned into decision support tools to enable use by the end users. So here's an example of the graphical user interface developed for one of our land cover mapping tools. In this case, a water mapping tool. We make our algorithms easy to use and accessible by anyone with basic geospatial knowledge and minimal experience with ArcGIS Pro. Without SMART, I can only speculate what my career trajectory would have been. But I suspect that I, like many other postgraduate PhDs, would have spent several years languishing as a postdoctoral researcher at a university. So I'm very fortunate to have received the SMART scholarship, which placed me directly into a research organization and allowed me to skip the postdoctoral research opportunity, directly empowering me as a scientist. Prior to graduating the PhD, I appreciated that SMART's funding enabled me to spend more time on other endeavors like teaching classes, traveling to conduct my field research, or delivering training sessions or talks at different universities across Southeast Asia. I've been able to do a lot of rewarding and fun research activities after graduation. I've traveled and presented at several scientific conferences representing the Geospatial Research Lab, and have had a chance to publish different research articles, apply for research funding, and conduct exciting research that has challenged me as a scientist. One of the most rewarding activities for me has been to guest lecture at West Point, as this gets me back to the fundamentals of remote sensing and allows me to remain in touch with students. Thank you very much for listening to my talk, and please let me know if you have any questions.
Thank you, Christopher. Next up, we have Robert Hart. His topic will be lightweight composite materials for military ground vehicles.
Hi, I'm Robert Hart. Thank you for joining my talk today on the work that I've been doing on lightweight composite materials for military ground vehicles. I joined the SMART program in 2014 as a PhD student at the University of Iowa studying mechanical engineering. And it was a really good fit that I got paired up with the U.S. Army's DEVCOM Ground Vehicle System Center because it really aligns with my past research background and has made for a very nice transition into my career. So the work that I perform at the Ground Vehicle System Center centers around lightweight vehicle structures for military ground vehicles. When we make military structures lighter, that results in improved mobility, increasing fuel efficiency and range of that vehicle, as well as reducing infield failures. All of these factors combined together can result in better combat effectiveness in theater. And when these vehicles weigh less, as we look to upgrade these vehicles in the future, there's an opportunity to add additional payload, such as sensors, weapons, or ammunition to those vehicles. And the way that my research ties into creating lighter weight ground vehicles is I focus on integrating lightweight structural composite materials and using advanced manufacturing processes in order to develop cost-effective, lightweight structures for our military ground vehicles. I'd like to share with you a larger research program that I lead at GVSC. This program is called Structural Thermoplastics for Vehicle. This program is looking at developing lightweight structural composite materials to integrate into our next generation combat vehicles. Now, some of you may be aware, there are some barriers historically to integrating composite materials in military ground vehicles. First of all, composite materials such as carbon fiber or fiberglass are known to be more expensive than traditional metals. They're difficult to manufacture, and there are additional design considerations that need to be required when integrating these into military applications. So this Structural Thermoplastics for Vehicles program was developed around four key strategic thrust areas to address these historic barriers to implementation. The first area is optimization of 3D printed tooling for composites. This thrust area focuses on reducing the upfront capital costs and manufacturing costs of producing composite materials. The second thrust area is actually prototyping lightweight composites for military vehicles. What we're doing here is demonstrating the affordable manufacturing processes on military relevant prototypes. The third area is addressing some of the inherent material characteristics or challenges with composite materials, in particular flame, smoke, and toxicity performance. And through a demonstration of a lightweight composite crew floor, we're actually showing that we can effectively use composite materials inside of a crew capsule and perform well against severe blast and flammability loads. The final thrust area is hybrid composite structures for military applications. And what we're doing in this thrust area is focusing on integrating composites with more traditional metal materials and developing durable, long-term solutions for joining these materials. And we're actually demonstrating this through a hybrid composite metal bridge hinge for a deployable bridge structure. So I'd like to go into a little more detail about some of the novel work we're doing in affordable manufacturing of composites. As you can see in the images here, we're using large format additive manufacturing to build rapid tooling at low cost so that we can produce composite materials at a rate and at economics that are favorable to military applications. So essentially what we're doing here is we're replacing traditional steel tooling with a 3D printed plastic that is able to produce structurally sound materials, composite materials for a military vehicle. By using additive manufacturing, we're able to reduce the upfront investment required for a traditional steel tool, and we're able to field composite prototypes faster than was previously possible. Another application I would like to highlight is my work in composites for extreme military environments. As I mentioned before, we are working on developing a lightweight composite crew floor for a military ground vehicle. Now, this crew floor needs to be safe from both a structural perspective, as well as protect the soldiers in case of an extreme environment, such as blast or a fire in the vehicle. And what we've been able to show through this project is using the affordable manufacturing processes as well as the high-performance composite materials, we're able to develop a crew floor that is over 55% lighter than an aluminum floor and is able to perform well against all types of blast and flame threats. So lastly, I'd like to share some of the successes that I've had in my career here at GVSC that were enabled through the SMART program. One of the biggest benefits, I think, to SMART was that I was able to do an internship while I was in graduate school. And I was able to start working with some senior level researchers to start to transition some of my graduate work into my future career. So early on, I was able to compete for and be awarded with multiple in-house research projects. And one of the innovation projects has actually resulted already in a patent application for a novel 3D printed band track for small robotic vehicles. In addition to this patent, I've had the opportunity to present at multiple conferences, had the opportunity to publish in multiple peer-reviewed journals, and was awarded with an award at the Ground Vehicle Systems Engineering Technology Symposium in 2018 for the best paper for my work on lightweight military ground vehicles. Lastly, I'd like to just share that one of the best outcomes, I think, of the SMART program and my work in the Army is actually getting to interface with the soldiers and gathering user feedback. I think that's one of the most rewarding parts of this job, is actually working to solve problems for real world situations in the Army. So at this point, I'd like to wrap up my talk by thanking the Army, the Ground Vehicle Systems Center, and the SMART program for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Finally, we have Michael Manser. His topic will be printed energy storage for soldier protection and sustainment.
Hello, my name is Michael Manser. I'm a mechanical engineer at the U.S. Army Combat Capabilities Development Command DEVCOM Soldier Center in Natick, Massachusetts. I pursued both my master's and bachelor's degrees in mechanical engineering through the SMART program at the University of Massachusetts Lowell. And today I'll be presenting a lightning talk to you on printed energy storage for soldier protection and sustainment. My work focuses on developing technologies to protect and sustain the warfighter. DEVCOM Soldier Center develops and innovates technologies in a variety of areas surrounding the dismounted soldier, from what they wear, to what they carry, to what they eat, to the shelters they sleep in. Pretty much the only thing we don't do is weapons or vehicles. My work primarily falls under the Army soldier lethality priority, in that we make soldiers more lethal by keeping them alive and prepared to accomplish their mission. Most of my work boils down to two main areas: developing materials for uniforms and equipment, and small unmanned aerial systems. In terms of developing materials for uniforms and equipment, this means creating materials that might be tailored for providing concealment from visual, IR, etc. They might be providing protection from different threats, electromagnetic threats, vector protection like mosquitoes. They might have sensing capabilities like chem sensing, or be part of a wearable power system, like I'll talk about in more detail today. And then the other piece of my work relates to small unmanned aerial systems. So again, this might be concealing small UAVs that might be considered an extension of the soldier's signature, developing systems for resupply or sensor deployment, and developing sensor platforms for increased situational awareness, like chem sensing and things like that. Today, I'm going to focus on wearable ionogel supercapacitors. This is a wearable energy storage solution that would complement batteries the soldier is carrying. This area is something that I started in during my first summer internship with DEVCOM Soldier Center, and I've continued working in it throughout my time in SMART. Once I arrived full-time at my facility, I continued to work in this area. The challenge here is hoping to address the fact that in the past, with a three-day mission, soldiers were required to carry 20 pounds of batteries, which is about 15 to 20% of their total load. And now with MDO, we have a seven-day mission without resupply, which is more than twice the number of batteries. And as you add equipment and you add smart devices, you're constantly increasing this power demand. As a result of this challenge, the Army has a need for lightweight wearable energy storage. It needs to be lightweight because, as I said, the longer the soldiers go without resupply, the more energy storage weight they're going to need. So making it as easy as possible to carry is critical. Additionally, with the rise of smart uniform features requiring additional power on the soldier and increased use of soldier-borne power generation and harvesters, you really need that energy storage technology to be wearable and on the soldier. The technology that's being proposed or being pursued through this effort is ionogel supercapacitors. So ionogel is a liquid salt. It's a lot safer than a traditional electrolyte found in kind of traditional batteries. It's a lot less flammable and a lot less toxic, which is extremely important when you're talking about something that you're going to have the soldier actually wear. Supercapacitors, in general, fill a capability gap between conventional capacitors and traditional batteries. So when you think of a traditional battery, it stores quite a bit of energy. It's very high energy, but it can only deliver this in kind of a low power way with very slow charge and discharge times. So it's providing slow, sustained energy. On the other end of the spectrum, you have conventional capacitors that are high energy, high power. They're providing a quick burst of just a little bit of energy. Supercapacitors fall kind of in the middle here, where you're going to have faster charge and discharge times than a battery, but a lot more energy than a capacitor. Because they charge and discharge a lot faster than the battery, supercapacitors are a more expeditionary form of energy storage. They can also better support kind of quickly charging up with soldier-borne power generation or through power beaming, and then you can quickly dispense that power to equipment as you need it. So quick bursts for communication, for sensing, whatever you need. And additionally, because of the way that the liquid salt works, it's the movement of ions in between. There's no chemical reaction happening like you would find in a battery, which means they can sustain an order of magnitude more charge-discharge cycles than a battery. And it's important to note here that supercapacitors will never be a replacement for a battery. For the same amount of power, you're always going to need a higher weight of supercapacitors, because as you can see where they fall in this energy density chart. But the benefit here is that charge-discharge time, it's the safety, and they can really not work instead of batteries, but with batteries, to provide those benefits of both kind of in an integrated system. This is a project that I've been working on throughout my time in SMART. While I was a SMART scholar as a student, I was working on a 6-2 project to develop flexible aerogel supercapacitors. The goal of that was to take the rigid traditional commercial supercapacitor architecture that you see on the far left and convert it to a flexible, more wearable form factor. This involved developing the aerogel electrolyte and optimizing the material selections to get a more flexible overall device. The result was this kind of middle device that you see. It was small, it was flexible, and it was very competitive with kind of other devices we were seeing in literature. And then when I began full-time, I proposed a seed effort to kind of further this with the goal of using the lessons learned from the first project and combining them with 3D printing and screen printing to reduce the packaging bulk and improve the performance by reducing the need for kind of discrete layers of within the device. And it was also to kind of demonstrate through these printing techniques a more scalable manufacturing method. And you can see kind of some of the results of this on the far right. So I believe that SMART had a major impact on my career. After my first internship at DevCom Soldier Center, I pursued SMART. And the reason that I enjoyed working for the DoD so much is that I think having a clear and meaningful application for the work that I'm doing is very motivating for me. And I like knowing that everything I'm doing is going to have a direct benefit for a soldier one day. I really like SMART for kind of two main reasons. One, I think it gave me a really solid continuity of work. So instead of a series of disconnected internships, I was able to repeatedly throughout the time I was in college, return to the same role, building skills and knowledge in that same kind of soldier technology area. Additionally, I think working as an intern for so many years, I was able to form like a professional network around my facility. And I feel that this gave me a real head start when it came to working full time and collaborating with different people. And a final kind of highlight, in my opinion, is that my ability to do STEM outreach in my role now, whether it's being a tour guide at the facility or judging science fairs or the primary thing that I do, which is working with eCyber Mission. I really find it rewarding to kind of work with students, get them interested in STEM, and then get them some amount of like recognition for their accomplishments. So that's all I have for today, but thank you for listening.
Thank you, Michael. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point, if you could navigate back to the agenda and click on the Q&A session, that will give you a Zoom link. Please follow that to get into our live Q&A session with our five speakers.